Good evening. This is Sakshi Ajmera from the Mood Court Association, and I would like to welcome you all to the second session of the MCA Alumni Teaching Program. The MCA, in collaboration with the Placement Coordination Committee and the Alumni Affairs Cell, would like to welcome Mrs. Neha Rai Mathur as the lecturer for this session. Mrs. Neha graduated from NLIU in 2005, and she pursued her LLM in Corporate and Financial Services from the National University of Singapore. Ma'am has previously worked with Khaitan & Company and AZB & Partners. Ma'am has also worked in the industry of trusteeship and family office firms, and has worked with Kotak Mahindra and ITCL Limited, and also IIFL Investment Advisors. At present, ma'am is the Vice President at Centrum Wealth Management Limited. We are very grateful that ma'am could take out time from her busy schedule for this session on estate planning as a career option, relevant laws and regulations. We would now like to welcome Neha ma'am to begin her session.
Thank you so much, Sakshi. And no ma'am business here. I'm Neha for all of y'all. We are from the same fraternity, so no ma'am business. And thank you, Sakshi, for this cute introduction of mine. I want to thank all of you all who are present on the forum. I hope this collaboration, both all of us, learn something. We have a nice, beautiful Tuesday evening. We learn something, and I really want to thank the MCA for organizing this. And so, as Sakshi just introduced me, I would like to briefly touch upon the introduction bit so as to come to my topic. So, when I graduated from NLIU and I joined Khaitan & Company, I was part of the real estate team. I used to deal with immovable properties, leave and license agreements, bulky sale deeds, and title search report. Which is very important part of any business or any job of a lawyer. But I thought it was very boring and mundane, same title search, going back to history 30 years and looking at who owned the property and is the title clear. And it was not a calling. So I thought, I can't do this real estate all through. And luckily, I was fortunate enough to get an opportunity with the corporate and fundraising team at AZB & Partners. And there I, as an associate, was working on due diligences for IPOs, taking care of private equity transactions, doing a lot of, companies law and FEMA and erstwhile DIP guidelines. Three, four private equity transactions and two, three capital market transactions. I was like, this is no rocket science. Do I really want to do this? Then I decided to take a break and go for my LLM in corporate and financial services law, because maybe some learning was left, which I didn't do in NLIU. And I went to Singapore. It was a good exposure to be in a foreign university, make friends from all across the world. And when I came back to India in 2008, Lehman Brothers had filed for bankruptcy and recession had hit India. It was a difficult time, but every time there is recession, government also thinks of, building its exchequer, like taking more tax from the people and ensuring that the fiscal is fine. And during that recession time, I was lucky enough to be part of wealth planning firms. And I started doing estate planning transactions, which I will explain to you what it means. And from there on, since 2009, I have been working with wealth planning firms. Now, that'll get me to the presentation or the topic that I'm going to present to you. So I'll just quickly open the presentation here. Let me know if you're able to view it. Y'all can see the presentation?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So I'll quickly tell you how I'm going to go about this topic today. I'll quickly explain what is estate. Then what do I do when I say I do estate planning? What all is covered in this? What exactly is the area of work? Practically, I'll tell you. Then I'll very briefly touch upon the relevant laws, because you all are students and you should know what to read, what not to read. Then I'll move to the very important topic, which is career option in estate planning. And the way forward is, you know, from this microscopic view, which I've covered in the first few, first four points, I'll go to a macro level telescopic view of understanding career options and how estate planning is a sine qua non for any lawyer. Then we'll go to the question answers. Okay. So let me explain what is an estate. Estate is everything that an individual owns, like you own your mobile, which is expensive, a laptop. Basically, there are four categories, broad categories of assets or estate. Immovable property in any form, agricultural, residential, commercial. Movable assets can be of various types, starting from your gold or artifacts and jewelry, watches, as I said, to the basic accounts which every individual has, is bank account, fixed deposits, deposit with post office. Then any employed person working will have a provident fund, employee provident fund. People take insurances, which is again part of their estate. It's a plan for the future. Then professionals will generally have movable assets from A to D. If it's a business family, they will have stakes in a listed company or unlisted company, partnership, or a sole proprietorship or LLP. Then people invest in shares and securities, whether listed or unlisted. Then you have a lot of other options available in the form of funds like AIF, mutual funds, exchange traded funds. Then there are debt products, debentures, and tax-free bonds, which the government issues. So basically, movable is a very wide category of assets which you can cover in the movable. Then comes intellectual property, which I'm sure all of you will study the various forms. Trademark being a very important, high-valued asset which individual will have in his balance sheet, and how trademark can be used and passed on from generations to generation. And the last one is digital assets. It's a new category of assets, like you have money in e-wallets, you have your blogs and photos on Instagram, which is also an asset that you own. It's your proprietorship. Okay, before I go to my next slide, since now you understand what an individual can own in the form of an asset, what as an estate planner I do is I take care of ensuring that these assets are enjoyed by the person during his lifetime in a very tax efficient manner, in a very prudent way, and they are secured for the next generations to come in a very systematic way. There is no dispute, there are no challenges, and still the asset is available in the best possible ways for the next generations, because each asset class has its own peculiar way of being dealt with. Have you ever thought that whatever assets that you own in your name, or you've bought out of your pocket money, or your parents have in their names, what will happen to it post their death? So a saying is there, dead men tell no tales, but their wills or succession plan or no succession plan can be a bit different. What I'm trying to say here is, if you don't plan the succession of your assets, then life is a little difficult. And if you don't plan it in proper way, then much more difficult. And some famous examples that we can talk about here is Birla Lodha. There was an issue with respect to will. Then the split between the Ambani brothers. Then how Singhania family, the Raymonds, I'm sorry about the spelling, it's Raymonds. How the father is now out of business and staying in a rented as an apartment as a tenant. And very close to our heart is erstwhile Amarchand Mangaldas, Suresh Shroff and company is now Cam and Sam. There again was an issue of will. Now you'll say that if this is such an important piece, why estate planning is not so popular in India? So there are a few things, a few myths rather. We Indians don't want to talk about death or think about death. We don't want to plan what will happen post-demise. Hum amar hain, hum aisa sochte hain. Other thing is, parents think everything will be hunky-dory when we go away. Our children, the siblings will have a very cordial relationship. They never anticipate a dispute on the assets that they leave behind post-demise. Another thing, very, very important point is, people think discussing money with an outsider, with a professional, it's third party. Why should an outsider come in the family matters? It's our personal affair. We'll take care of it. And last, a very important point is, there is no death tax or inheritance tax or estate tax in India? To briefly, I'll touch upon this topic in further slides, but what is inheritance taxes? It's applicable in rest of the jurisdictions all over the world, but in India, it was abolished in India rather in 1986. Inheritance taxes, say I have 100 rupees in my balance sheet when I die, that 100 rupees, it will directly go to the children in India. They'll become owner of that 100 rupees. But if I were a US citizen, a US resident, if I leave behind 100 rupees, my children will get only 60 rupees there, because there is a 40% estate tax, inheritance tax in the US. Now, what is estate planning? Let's go to the next slide. So what we do is we plan the estate, how to deal with the estate during your lifetime and post your lifetime after you are gone. During your lifetime, there are a few concerns, like there are business people and there are some people in profession. Now, you need to ensure that your assets are segregated. Like if I were in business, I had given a personal guarantee and I've filed my personal balance sheet with my personal guarantee, then my entire personal assets, the house where me and my family live, can be attached by the banks, because insolvency laws are very strict now. So as a business person, I need to ensure that my personal assets, my family is secured. Even if my company goes bust, I have taken care of my family members. So you need to separate your business and personal assets. And we do planning according to the objective of each family. The other important topic is marital discord. If you own a lot of asset and if your marriage goes bad, then the maintenance and alimony, it becomes an issue. And therefore, it is very important for the patriarch to plan for these issues. Preserving assets for future management in the most tax efficient way, as I mentioned, that there are various kinds of taxes applicable. And so we need to plan each asset according to, the capital gains tax, variety of taxes are there. Then global tax efficiency. So a lot of families, that children, parents are in India, but children either take up green card in the US or they shift to Australia, they become permanent residents of Australia. So each jurisdiction has its own tax liability. Whatever income you earn in that jurisdiction or whatever income you earn in India may have to be reported in the jurisdiction where you are. So it is important that you plan your investments according to the global tax applicable. Now, post your lifetime, same thing, intergenerational wealth transfer in the most cost-effective manner and hassle-free manner. Controlling the end use of funds. So if there are two children, one is spendthrift and one is very, business-minded and very sorted, one should not take advantage of the other. Both the children should get it equally. So end use of funds needs to be controlled. Providing for financial support of the family. So there may be an old mother in the family. And if something happens to patriarch, the mother needs to be taken care of. You never know, the grandchildren will do it or not. So you need to provide for the elderly people, senior citizens. If there is a special child in the family, like somebody is autistic, can't take decisions on his own, then you have a lot of ways and means to plan around that. Then there is a transfer cost involved when an asset is transferred from one person to another. So you need to minimize all the ancillary costs attached to it. And best is to reduce any family dispute. Okay, am I going too fast or we are good? Sakshi?
It's good. Yeah, it's good, it's good.
Okay.
It's not too fast.
All right. You can stop me if you think it's too fast or something. Okay. Now, so as I said, there are various tools available to do estate planning. The first and foremost is don't do anything. Don't write any will. Don't do any tool which is available. If you've not used any of them, then you die intestate. And people who have studied family law from the audience will understand this, because you have the best of teacher teaching family law to use, Debushree Sarkar. I don't need to go into the technicalities because for my academic queries, I referred the matter to Debushri. So when you don't write a will that is intestate, and then your personal laws come in. If you're a Muslim, the Sharia law will apply. If you're a Hindu, your Hindu Succession Act of 1956 will apply. So on and so forth. So it's a scenario where if there's no issue and nothing is there, you follow the law of the land and get the things rolling. Other option available is gifting during lifetime. There's no gift tax in India. And gifting between relatives is at a nominal stamp duty. I can just execute a gift deed for, say, a flat which my father owns. He has two other children, but he wants that this flat should go to Neha. So he can, during his lifetime, take me to the sub-registrar office, execute a gift deed where, as per the sub-registrar's record, I will become the owner. It's a gift at zero consideration. So gifting during lifetime is the simplest and cheapest option. However, like Mr. Singhania of Raymond's family, he did give everything away to the son and he's out. So it is not a prudent option. Now, another thing which people do is nomination. They say all my financial assets, they have nominations in my DMAT account. I have nominations for my bank account. So what's the big deal if I die and my nominations will kick in? For your information, as per Indian law, nominee is just a trustee for the time being. He is not the legal owner of the asset. The legal heirs are the real owners of that asset. So for example, let's take example of my father, he opened a bank account where he made me a nominee, but in the will he wrote everything should go to my wife. Okay, as a nominee, I have all the right to go to the bank and take out all the money. But my mother has a claim against me that I was just a nominee, a trustee for the time being. The ownership belongs to my mother. Or if third party is a nominee, then things become uglier. You know, say for example, a nephew or a niece is appointed as a nominee who's not a legal heir as per Hindu law. You'll understand the legal heirs, class one heirs, class two heirs as per Hindu law. So I'm taking example of a Hindu. So for my father, if he has nominated his nephew as a nominee and the nephew withdraws all the money from the bank, bank will ask no questions. Bank will say, nominee, your name nominee, I'll give you everything. But it's the legal heirs, which is the wife and the children, the mother of a male Hindu, who are entitled to this. Joint ownership, again, if you have read your transfer of property laws, there are two concepts, joint ownership and tenancy in common. I don't want to go into the technicalities again, but joint ownership is just one way of doing it, but you need to word this document appropriately. Now we'll come to a very beautiful piece, which is testamentary succession writing of wills. Wills is what? Will is a document, it's a wish letter basically, where there are three parties: the testator who's writing the will, the beneficiaries for whose benefit the assets will be left, and the executor. Executor is one who executes the will. In the will, I can list down all my assets and ask the executor to transfer it to the beneficiaries in the manner I have decided. People can write a will. You just Google a will document, it will come very handy. There are online wills available. But the simple point is, will can be easily contested in the court of law. So it is very much required that you do it professionally. Just, you know, you all are going to be lawyers and you know legal drafting and how it can be interpreted. So whenever you draft a will, you have to read it as if a judge is going to interpret it in this way. So every time you draft, it's a tip for you, takeaway. While drafting any document as a corporate lawyer or as a drafting person, you need to view it from the lens of a judge. If it goes through the court proceedings, how will this be interpreted? In my favor or against me? So be very careful when you're drafting any document. Okay. Now, other creature of doing estate planning is trust. I don't know if you've read the Arkic 1882 Trust Act. It talks about setting up of trusts, private family trust. This has no business with the charitable trust or the temple trusts that are in place for claiming tax exemption and for all the purposes that let's not talk about. A private family trust is set up for family members. and the relatives are defined in the Income Tax Act. So, one second. Okay. Now, yeah, so trust is settled by a settlor for the benefit of beneficiaries, and the asset is to be managed by the trustee. I'll reiterate the definition of a trust as per the Indian Trust Act. It's an obligation reposed by the settlor on the trustee for the benefit of beneficiaries, so three parties. Now, you can do a lot of planning around your estate with the help of a trust. Though trust is not a legal entity as per Indian Trust Act, however, once you've got your trust deed done, which is the Bible for operations of a trust, you'll get a PAN from Income Tax Department for that. You'll get a bank account. You can open DMAT account. So just like an individual has a PAN and an entity for income tax purposes, a trust is a legal creature there. And, you know, it's a tool which is used widely to work on or plan for your estate duties in the US and UK and other jurisdictions. You know, if you set up a proper trust, then you can save on your inheritance or death taxes too, you know, for you to remember. Now, other important aspect of doing succession planning is having a family arrangement document. Family arrangements, you all will know, when you can read a lot of case laws around this, are it's an agreement between the family members to manage not only the assets or the wealth, how will it flow to individuals, but it also talks about, you know, it can talk about rituals or morals of the family. It's not only a legal document per se, it's a more of a moral document, so to say. Family arrangements come very handy in case there is a dispute, because the patriarch of the family is no longer there, but he has penned down his wishes regarding use of family business, shareholding, or any, you know, moral obligations in the family arrangement document. And courts give a lot of sanctity to these documents. I'll come to the costs involved in all those things, but to quickly reiterate, family arrangements come very handy and are recognized by court of law. It's like a prenup when you do, which officially not recognized, but courts have started giving sanctity to it. Other ways of planning around your assets, you know, now you'll know that the income taxes rates are so high that people have started siphoning off assets from their balance sheet into separate entities, which can be a LLP or a partnership firm or a HUF, and just in order to have a separate PAN. So you can plan around these things. It's a little technical, but just to give you a heads up, there these entities also help in setting up, in doing your estate planning. Now, if you have NRI family members, it's very much required that you look into the investments, because there are restrictions for NRIs to do in India and outside of India. There are tax liabilities attached to it and the death tax. So planning around all that. Now, next is insurance. So one tool for planning for a business family, MWP means Married Women's Property Act. It's more archaic than the Trust Act of this MWP is 1877 or 72, I think. What does it do is, say, suppose my husband is doing some business and he may go insolvent, the business may go bust, and he may have to file for bankruptcy. So what will happen is, if he has not done any of these things, neither has done a trust nor has written a will, if he has in his sane decision taken insurance for the benefit of family members, where married woman is, you know, if you just have to sign a form when you're taking insurance, any insurance for that matter, you sign an MWP form and you name your wife and your children as beneficiaries. So if he has set up, you know, taken an insurance of 1 crore rupees, he's basically depositing that money as towards premium, but that money is mine or my children's. Even if he divorces me, that money will be mine. He can't take back that money. So it's a very good tool. It's not used very much in India. It's even the insurance companies don't talk about it, but it's about awareness. Then last option is to look at your residency in tax haven jurisdictions, which is, again, let's not go into a lot of details. A lot of things need to be discussed around this, but it's one important aspect when you do estate planning. Okay, now very quickly, I'll just these 11 things which I want you to see is family law. I told you Indian Succession Act, the relevant laws I'm talking about, Hindu Succession Act, Trust Act, income tax laws. So income taxes, you have various heads of income. Basics, when you study the tax law, please try and understand the concepts, because this is very much required in any practice of law, wherever you go, whether you do litigation, whether you do corporate, whether you become a judge, or whether you are in research and teaching, because you will end up paying these taxes once you have these incomes. So there are various heads of income. You need to understand this. Then when you are in business and you have companies, then you need to understand capital gains and, demerger and slump sale, which is very, very relevant. Then next aspect is property and registration laws. I'm sure you've studied registration laws, Torrens system of registration, I remember from my classes. You should know the basics, very important. Stamp duty laws. Stamp duty act, if you see, it's a state subject. Every state you work for or where your client is, you need to understand the stamp duty, because any legal document that you draft has to be stamped, and stamp duty in each state varies, and it's worded as 0.2 paisa of every 100 rupees, 20 paisa of every 100 rupees. It's very important. While you're in college, only start going through the Stamp Act and start reading it. Company law, of course, it's the favorite subject for all aspiring corporate lawyers, so please thorough it. And then securities law, if it's a listed company, takeover code comes in. Then the Estate Duty Act, which I told you, it has been repealed, but there's a likelihood it may be reintroduced in India, because again the exchequer is going through a tough time. They want money. Rich can't get richer, poor can't get poorer. So economics of scale calls for reintroduction of estate duty. Partnership laws, intellectual property rights, again a very good practice of law, and also planning around succession of the IPRs is important. A very interesting piece is ADR, and I am not talking about arbitration and conciliation. It is just like your civil dispute, because you have to get the order of the arbitrator enforced in the court. Mediation is a very beautiful, I'm saying beautiful because, mediator needs a lot of understanding of every aspect of humanity, not only law, to resolve disputes. So just study dispute resolution in such a way that you become a little compassionate and just not follow the adversarial system of law. So these things you need to, while you're in law school, please touch upon this and brush up. Now is the career option. So I happen to, land in this estate planning business because of, let's say, recession or jobs not being there, but this is very close to my heart. I enjoy my work. And I've quoted this famous line from the common law that life of law has not been logic, but it has been experience. And though Estate Duty Act is not there in India, there are likelihood that it will be reintroduced. Once it is reintroduced in India, wealth planning firms, estate planners will be mushrooming all over India. They are there in small pockets, but this practice will be required by each family who owns assets, and every family does. So what are the options available? So there are a few law firms who have private client practice. When I say private client practice, they serve the ultra HNIs and they plan their succession planning. So they have a very, very interesting, a very niche practice area. Very few law firms have it. I am not going and naming them. You can find it for yourself. Then trustee companies. So SEBI lists down some 31 trustee companies which are registered with SEBI. But they are debenture trustees. Debenture is the product which I said, it's a debt product. When a company issues debentures, then they need to register with start with a trustee company. They need to have a trustee company in place. I'm not talking about that trustee company per se. It's the trustee business which I talked about under the private family trust. These trustee companies are professional trustees who help private families to act as trustees. It's just the administrative job. But an individual can also act as a trustee. You don't need a company per se. But there are many banks who have trustee companies. Many private companies are acting as trustee company, and they provide the services. Another aspect where there's a lot of scope is wealth management firms. Now, wealth management firms are what? It's the it's a relationship manager of any client who has various investments in various products, and it's managed through a professionally driven advisory firm, which is a wealth management firm. There, all the wealth management clients, or as every bank will have, a purple card or various color codes for ultra HNIs and HNIs. So there's a RM attached to it, a relationship manager, and there's a legal team like me sitting in the wealth office helping them understand the estate planning piece. Family office, very, very innovative term. When I say family office, so say let's take, for example, Tata's or the family which runs Hero Motor Corp. They will have they'll have their huge treasury, whatever transactions, the business they do, they whatever profits they earn, they don't keep it as cash, hard cash, liquid. They will keep on investing in products which will give them returns. So that churning of money is managed by their internal family office. It's a dedicated IIM graduate who will look at the money inflow and investments and interest, and a lawyer sitting there doing all the transactions. They will invest not only in startups, they will invest in products. So it's a family office within a company. It's a very niche term. You should do some research on this. Very, very, very popular outside of India, but in India, it's gearing up slowly. There are big family offices like Infosys has, or Hero Motor Corp has. I know people there, that's why I'm taking these names. Then banks servicing ultra HNIs, they also take care of this piece to the limited extent possible at their end. Okay, now this was as an estate planner what you can do. However, this piece is very, very relevant for any lawyer. Any lawyer should know for an individual client. Client can be a corporate, but it is run by shareholders. So each shareholder, each director, each key managerial person, any professional who has ESOPs and has a lot of wealth around him needs to do estate planning. However, you all as students over here will have a lot more options. And the way forward for you all, just to briefly cover that point before we go into question answers, you can join a law firm, their corporate team, or their litigation team. You can join in the corporate team also. There are a lot of segregations like a capital markets, a real estate, an IPR, or a power projects. So any team you join, you are catering to a company or an individual. And any individual there needs estate planning. You become an in-house counsel in any company like an ACC Cement or Tata or ITC. Again, in-house counsel's job is wide. He's a key managerial person. And the general counsel is the key managerial person. So a lot of things can be worked around depending on which industry you join. Then you can join judiciary, there's litigation, you can join a bank, government or semi-government entity, and you can do your research and join, be a teacher, a professor. So these are the broad options available to you. My only submission is wherever you are, you need to be knowing how to do estate planning. You need to be very compassionate with your client when you are talking about, so what will happen if you're not there tomorrow? Does your wife even know where your assets are? You're making so much money, burning the midnight oil, but what at the end of the day? What if there are disputes? What if your children are not able to enjoy it? If there are minor children, a lot of issues come around this. So estate planning as a service, it's not only from a earning perspective, it's also from a compassion perspective. Okay, now I'll quickly go into some statistics and some facts to just highlight the point that you as lawyers have a lot of scope. The source of this information is SEBI. The benchmark I'm saying is market capitalization. So people trade on the stock exchange. If you look at the statistics, India does only 2.8% of the total global stock market capitalization, which is minuscule. Number of IPOs that we do is only 6% of the total IPOs done globally. And the resources raised also through IPO is only 2.7%, which are raised globally. Now, our population in India is 125 to 130 crores, roughly. And how many DMAT accounts are there? That means people trading online is only 4 crore 15 lakh with NSDL and CSDL. You'll once you go to the SEBI website and NSDL, CSDL, you'll understand all these things. What I'm trying to say is how many, like you can check with your parents. your parents, father and mother. Father will have a DMAT account because he had a bank account with, say, a private bank at an Axis or something. But how much trading does he do? Minuscule. You know, investment in mutual funds is subject to market risk. But at the end of the day, it's a secured investment. And people in India are still not doing that. So once a company decides to trade its stock on market and the general public invest in it, a lawyer is needed. A lawyer needs to, you know, do the necessary applications, filing, drafting, everything. And another important piece is, you know, India ranks third in family-owned businesses. And 70% of businesses in India are family businesses. Raja ka beta, Raja, nepotism, the debate that is going on right now, nepotism. It's everywhere, especially in family businesses. Even if the third generation is not capable of handling that business and there are professionals available outside, the patriarch will not employ an outsider. He will want his children only to take care of business. And there is a lot of scope in doing family arrangement around this piece. The third generation can retain ownership and enjoy the benefit out of that business. But there are ways of appointing professionals, you know, who can run the show in a more efficient manner, take businesses to the fourth generation, because generally at the third generation, businesses just go, they're closed because there's no earning. The third generation doesn't have an interest, or something or the other wrong happens and businesses get closed. So how a family arrangement document, how working around each estate, how planning for the future is very important or a very interesting piece for you all to pursue. And with that, I will say thank you. That was it from my side. I can stop sharing and see you all. If you can open your cameras, I'll be happy to see all of you all.
Ma'am, there is one question that has Please. Come up. Can't we have power of attorney because it also has less stamp duties?
Interesting. Very interesting. I didn't mention that point because a power of attorney becomes a very handy tool for dealing with the assets by individuals. So, for example, my brother went to US. He gave a power of attorney to my father to deal with that property. But a power of attorney can be revoked anytime. And sub-registrars, a lot of misuse happened around the usage of power of attorney. Like it was given to employees in a company. A lot of misuse happened. So, you know, the use is very restrictive in the sense it's monitored and it's not allowed by the sub-registrar. It's a handy tool for family members because stamp duty is less, of course. Very good point. But there are misuse which has happened in past. So we need to be very careful about issuing a power of attorney, especially a general power of attorney, which you know, lists down all the assets and say you can deal with everything under the sun. What if the power of attorney holder just withdraws that money for his own benefit? You know, so there are disadvantages to a power of attorney. Unless it's a close confidant that to whom you're giving, it's fine.
Are there any questions? Ma'am, there's a question. Praveen, you can unmute yourself and ask.
Hey, all of you all open your camera. Right. I want to see all of you all.
And please unmute yourself.
In case of implementation of Estate Act is delayed, will opportunities still grow in estate planning? See, 2000.
Yes,
yeah. Hi, Pravi. So I joined the estate planning team in 2009. And since 2007, we've been hearing it will be reintroduced. But it still has not been. However, people, the affluent families who are, you know, understanding how the system works and they are, you know, they understand the politics and how regulations are passed, when they'll be passed, all those families. I've done in my life almost 500 to 600 trusts for ultra HNIs and the big businesses. And they are creating dummy structures and keeping it that whenever this law is introduced, our structure is up and running. Even if it is delayed, people die. People want to write wills. People want to do structures from a business perspective, from a special child perspective. So, you know, there is always a scope for a lawyer.
Thank you, ma'am.
Any other questions? I think there aren't.
I'll have a question for, I can see only Gokul here. Gokul, you're in final year, I believe.
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. So, does this resonate or sound interesting to you, this particular piece? Or do you think it's like, how boring? Like, I used to think of a real estate or a mergers and acquisition document, just from a fresher perspective.
I think that it's a very new perspective, novel perspective for us. Mm-hmm. Learning estate planning as actually a career option that is available to us, and in such a large scale, because this was something that we always believed that was generally happening behind the curtains within the families and not much into the commercial perspective. The law firms actually practicing it in such a wide level, in a greater level.
Yes.
I think that's a very good opportunity for us. I mean, learning that, okay, this is one field of law that is always available. Like, we got to learn new laws, like of PMT available to us. This is also a good option and a good way out.
Great.
There's another question.
Yes.
Yeah.
Two investment banks Swastik. And brokerage firms. Swastik. Where is Swastik? Let him only read the question. Swastik, can you hear us? Is he there or no?
I mean, he is there.
Yes, ma'am. Good evening, ma'am.
Hi. No, ma'am. I'm Neha.
Okay. Actually, ma'am, it would be a bit too awkward for me. So I would just call you ma'am for now.
Sure. Okay.
Ma'am, actually, my question was that private businesses, they go public, they release IPOs through investment banks and brokerage firms. So do these firms also employ corporate lawyers for like estate planning?
For estate planning per se, I am skeptical because it's not a revenue generating business for them. I'll mm-hmm. tell you very honestly, most of the time I need to be compassionate not only with the work that I'm doing, but compassionate with the fees that I'm charging. Like, mm-hmm. let it go, please. It's just a will. So, investment banking firms are brutal, honestly. They need business, and brokerage firm are also brutal. So, mm-hmm. they will not employ a lawyer for estate planning. But if you offer it to a client as an ancillary service, like most of the law firms were already doing it, what the client comes back is, why don't you act as executor? Why don't you act as trustees? I trust you. So, you know, a lot of personal touch needs to be given to this business. As an advisory, yes, it will be a good exercise on the part of the investment banker or a broker to provide, but it's all business-minded approach. So.
Okay, got it, ma'am. Thank you very much.
No problem. Interesting question, by the way, Swastik. Like,
thank you, ma'am.
No problem. Thank you so much.
Any more questions?
Good evening, ma'am. This is Ronak Doshi. I'm a student of first year. I have one question related to the concept of will that you were teaching.
Uh-huh.
So, like, it's kind of a hypothetical situation, but this might happen that someone from a family, so before he or she dies, they want their property to always remain with their family. But in case of will, once they transfer the property to their children, it becomes on children's choice. So what do they want to do with the property?
Correct.
However, is it possible for a person to put a restrictive stipulation with respect to that the property always remains with the family?
Okay, so see, when you write a will, it comes into effect post-lifetime. While you're drafting a will, say husband drafts a will to say that my son should become the owner of that property, the only restrictive condition on ownership being transferred to the son is that my wife will have a living rights in this property till she is alive. So every asset that you're intending to transfer through a will has to have a beneficiary name to that asset. Otherwise, it's an incomplete will. However, the restrictions which are recognized by court as feasible are living rights. but the enjoyment of the property or the ownership rather, ownership has to go to a particular beneficiary. You can't, in a will, you know, will gets executed post-demise immediately, like within 6 months or wherever probate is required, you need to get a probate. Otherwise, it has to be executed immediately. You can't bind the executor of a will for, say, next 50, 60 years. It's an impossible task, and nobody will be rather alive to execute the will till so long. It's instead of a will, if the objective of the family is to secure the asset in within the family, it's better to do a trust. You know, you can park the asset in a trust, name the beneficiary, have a trustee in place, either individual or corporate, and then, you know, decide on how the asset will pass on. When will it ultimately go to the beneficiary? Will is not a, you know, an entity per se. Will is just a document, a wish letter. So your objective will not be met. I hope I answered the question that you had.
Yes, ma'am. Thank you so much.
Most welcome. You can think through. We have time till 6. We still have time. So let's not rush with questions. In the meantime, I can talk to you on, if you have questions, please stop me. You have a lot of options available, as I discussed, from a career point of view, and I talked about compassion and all those things. There's one STEP organization, STEP. I know nobody in law school studies family law. I mean, I never studied trust law. I did some empirical project and got done with it. I never opened that Indian Trust Act. Now I have by-hearted it. And family law, those sapindas and all were like a killer. But now I find it very interesting, honestly. I've bought that book, which Debashree always tells. I'm also reading that book. I don't have it right now, otherwise I would have showed you as a proof. So family law is interesting only when you have a scenario or empirically you think about it. It is academically, it's very boring and dry topic. But you think of your own family. If you have, like your grandfather had 6 or 7 children and you had 2 or 3 properties, whether it was just an equitable on your the grandfather's part to distribute it in the way he did it while not leaving a will or leaving a very incomplete will, whether you had to go to the court of law, as think in a very practical way and have a solution-oriented approach, you know, to any issue. When I say solution-oriented approach, like I will ask my parents to write a will now. At least we are sorted. This is a solution. In hindsight, you'll think through. Like my family, I'm from Bhopal. It was a big family, and it's nowhere in existence right now because there were disputes with respect to property. There was huge property, and it was not planned. It's still, you know, they've become debris. Such huge properties is now lying vacant and it's under sub judice. It's all under litigation. It's very sad. I mean, I see it and I feel sorry about it that I practice this law, but it's every individual who has an immovable property should have a will, because not only from vicious perspective, like even if you have one child or say one daughter, one son, your daughter is sorted, but your son needs to get that property, will become so handy from administrative convenience. You can just go with the death certificate and the copy of the will. No other documents will be asked for. So from administrative convenience also, it is prudent for every person who has a PAN. That means he has an asset. That means he's paying tax. Any asset that you own, you need to plan for its succession. Otherwise, it is left to the personal laws. And a clerk sitting in the sub-registrar office or a clerk sitting in the bank has no legal understanding, no practical understanding. He'll go by the book and your life will be a mess. I've seen so many people suffer. They have to go to the court, get a succession certificate, a letter of administration, tehsildar ke paas, magistrate ke paas. It's just running around for a small piece of asset. It may not be small when it comes to valuation of it, but there's a lot of stress. I'm sorry about this crying. Somebody's crying here. All I'm saying is each one of you just go back and talk to your father. Have you even listed down your assets? Nobody even makes asset register. Asset register is what? I will just write down my bank account, which bank, whether a nominee is in place or not. Do a nomination audit for all the assets. Even if you don't write a will, if a nominee is in place, which is your wife and husband, vice versa, you're sorted. Does your all your like mothers who are housewives or even working, do they even know where the other spouse is investing, where all the money is from investment perspective? There are so many cases where husband, you know, who's the sole breadwinner, one of my clients, he was working with some IT firm. All his assets were logged in his Excel sheet, which was a password protected document. He met with a road accident. The laptop was crashed. Nobody knew where his assets are. The wife had to go through, she had to borrow money for the child's education, even after being filthy rich, because everything was under, you know, stop, hard stop. So listing down assets is the basic thing which every individual should do and inform the you know, relatives. Why are we earning so much? We need to ensure that the assets are enjoyed by the people for whom you're earning. So listing down assets, doing a nomination audit, it's very basic to everybody. That's why I said compassion. You need to understand clients' need. And everybody is a client. You ask your uncles, or the people in business, have you given personal guarantees? Do you think you're sorted? What if you go bankrupt? What if the business goes bust? Have you thought through? Have you talked about MWP insurance? Is anybody even aware in business that MWP insurance is available? Even if you go insolvent, if the insurance you've taken is MWP protected, Married Women Property Act, then insolvency proceedings also, you cannot touch that property. It's as simple, but nobody knows about it. I've talked a lot. The basic thing is just pen down your assets, list down your wishes. That's a will. Then when it comes to complicated family or people who have child with special needs, so one child is normal, one child is autistic. Who will take care of that autistic child? How have you planned? What if the sibling is not, maybe she has the intention to take care, but what if she's working in the US? How will the child in when he's a major, who will take care of his needs? A simple trust can help. You know, you appoint a friend as a trustee, you just have to sign checks to the trust you've set up during your lifetime. The money will go to the beneficiary's need. It's very simple things, but everybody ignores it. Like, it's like, we'll do it tomorrow. And that tomorrow just never comes. And it's like, then people come to such standstill. Like today only I was telling Sakshi, one of my clients has written a will. It's registered also, though not required by law. He has written it incomplete will. It's written 10 years back when I was not even in the profession. Somebody has written it. A chartered accountant has written it, like the munshi of the family. And it's worded in such a way that 80 crore worth of his financial assets may go to charity. You have to list down an asset, list down a beneficiary. It's very simple. It's simple for lawyers, of course, but people ignore it royally. So I think if you will go back to your family, ask your dads, have you written a will? Have you listed down your assets? That's the start of the story for you to learn this piece. That's the end of it. And then you'll always have this soft corner for each of your client. And client will be happy if you give this add-ons. So my simple request will be, don't read all the laws. I'm sure you've cleared your exam, but just look at the importance of this piece. And any practice area, you just use this and you'll remember me that, oh, that lady told us to read this and how my client is happy with me. So that's the only request.
Any more questions? Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am, for this
question. Please.
Yeah. So, relating to what you just said, ki will hona chahiye.
Mm-hmm.
So with respect to that, you just gave an example ki all the assets were listed in a particular document in his computer.
Mm.
So, this is something which might happen a lot of times.
Yes.
So, what are the alternatives available to a family member with respect to finding what properties did the member actually own?
So, see, if you don't write a will, if you store everything in a soft copy, which is a simple way of doing it, you're taking out an A4 size sheet or maintaining a diary with all the insurances that you've taken, all the bank accounts you've maintained, and updating that status and keeping your spouse informed about it. That, okay, I haven't written a will, but I've listed down all the assets. Now, if the wife is the only legal heir, the wife will get it. But make an index of all the assets that you own.
Okay, so is there any government repository which keeps a record of the assets owned by a particular individual?
You will not want to go to the government for this, no. You'll not want to disclose your assets to the government. I mean, there's a lot of tax, dude. It's just a simple diary. Government Digi Locker, which I also have, where I upload only my scan copies, which I need to show at the airport or some places. But I wouldn't want to list down my NSDL statement in a government website because it will show all the holdings and the money that I've been investing in stock exchange. All the categories of assets that I shared with you, like immovable property, you have a sale deed, which you keep at either a bank locker or in the locker at your home. Then you have bank locker, the keys you will store at home. So each asset needs to be dealt with in a very, it has sanctity to it. My jewelry, I'll keep it in bank locker. Whatever I'm using, I'll keep it at home. But I'll keep it in safe locker. And I have maintained a diary. Now, one of my clients recently, she had a lot of jewelry and she couldn't decide between the two sons who are married. So two daughter-in-law and one daughter, which piece to go to whom. What she's done is she's taken pictures of 125 pieces of jewelry. She's written a will and she has said that the will shall be distributed as per the photographs that I've taken. Jewelry should be distributed in the manner that I have done is each photograph behind the photo, I have named a beneficiary. And smartly, she wrote the name of beneficiary in pencil. If anybody acts funny with her, she'll just erase the name and change the beneficiary. So for each asset, how do you transfer it? It's a discretion. But listing down assets is like, you should do it not tomorrow, today. Why people are not switching on their camera? I want to see all of you all. Why? They are not dressed. Anyways, I know it's a little technical and too much for you all to deal with, but as with experience, you'll understand these things. Once you build your own assets, once you start working and you have hefty salaries, you'll buy movable property, you'll get your DMAT accounts, you'll take insurances, then you'll understand that this is very, very important. And Sakshi, you can share my contact details. All the ultra HNIs on this call, please contact me for their parents or relatives, estate planning. On a lighter note, I'm always there. Any query, wherever you get stuck, not only estate planning, generally, professionally, also career wise, or any issue, just I'm a call away.
Okay. Thank you so much, ma'am. It was a very interesting and an engaging session. And we hope a lot of participants get inspired and take up estate planning as their career option. And we are very grateful to you that you took out time from your schedule for this session. We also look forward to hosting you for more such sessions if we fit in your schedule.
Absolutely, absolutely.
Thank you so much. I'll also share your details with the others.
Sure. Thank you. I'll take your leave. Best of luck to all of you all.
Thank you. Be a